This is the second session, but we're switching the second presentation with the first. I'm Jiska Cohen-Mansfield from the Minerva Center for Interdisciplinary Study of End of Life. And it's my great pleasure and honor to introduce Professor Shane Neilson. He's a physician at the University of Guelph, Student Health Services. He's a Vanier Scholar and PhD candidate at McMaster University in the Department of English and Cultural Studies. And besides this formal part, he's a poet and a writer, and we're very honored to have you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This is working? Yeah. Thanks for having me. Thanks specifically to Shai and Hagai for inviting me here. And thanks everyone for being here. Just gonna begin. I'm gonna cheat a little bit. This is called the pain face. Rigid, stoic, mask, broken bone face, gunshot face, sun dead face, look. The face, see your rictus, fortune, and icterus, the yellow glow on a 1 to 10 scale. Consider the pain face, love on your lip, love sliding sideways to make a silly face of pre and post. Profess systems of belief, of research, corollary, sing, agreeably sing, of pain, a shadow cast by this edifice, the love face. Pain's place is pictorial, 100,000 atlases of your face, tear-stained, unfathomed by intense algorithms of validated claims. See the pain face. Underneath it is no face. It's from my poet self there. My talk is going to be about how language mediates the experience of pain, how it largely structures it. It's called Pain as Metaphor. In our landmark study, The Body in Pain, who, Scary being someone that we brought up already this morning, she memorably pointed out that pain finds its way into language almost exclusively through metaphors of weaponry and damage. So for example, burning, stabbing, crushing, ask someone in a clinic how pain feels and they'll reach for those words, naturally. I build on this observation by arguing that pain is conceptualized and expressed through negative and destructive metaphorical systems that have been appropriated by physicians and entrenched with supplementary neurological metaphors. I argue further that the incredible accumulation of detail concerning pain pathways, the holy grail of pain research, is reliant upon certain theoretical constructs that might be distant in time, yet are influential in effect. Elaborations upon these theories with experimental knowledge and minute elaboration of physical detail, the so-called mechanistic view of pain, do not change the metaphors we use to understand the physiological information. Because the benefit of seeing a medical practitioner, such as myself, and the treatment of pain is modest, the accumulation constitutes a meaningless ubiquity, an authoritative edifice of medical knowledge that is an illusion of authority, that the authority derives from knowledge that is based on destructive metaphors should make anyone suffering from pain, or anyone who loves someone suffering from pain, quite circumspect. One of the foundational texts that informs my talk is Metaphors We Live By. It's a seminal text on metaphor written by George Lakoff and Mark Johnson at USC. They define metaphor, and I quote, as a way of conceiving of one thing in terms of another, and its primary function is understanding. So largely my argument is the metaphors that we use shape how we understand the world. They're the basic mechanism that we rely upon in order to make something like something else or not like something else, so that we can understand what they're like and not like. All disciplines resort to metaphor for the means of their understanding, and Lakoff and Johnson demonstrate how pervasive metaphorical thinking is. But also that much of our metaphorical thinking is based on arbitrary conventions that aren't preserved across cultures, which I think is something that came up in the response to the first talk today. Nietzsche elucidated a strange property of metaphor in On Truth and Falsity in their extramoral sense. Quote, "What therefore is truth? A mobile army of metonymies, metaphors, anthropomorphisms. In short, a sum of human relations which became poetically and rhetorically intensified, metamorphosed, adorned, and after long usage, seemed to a nation fixed, canonic, and binding. Truths are illusions of which one has forgotten that they are illusions." Disciplines progress according to the strength of their metaphors. And those metaphors are fated to become so familiar that they transform into illusions, if even thought of at all. Nietzsche adds that in an earlier age, language worked the construction of ideas. In latter times, it is what he refers to as science. Quote, "Just as the bee," metaphor-laden definition here, "just as the bee works at the same time at the cells and fills them with honey, thus science works irresistibly at that great columbarium of ideas, the cemetery of perceptions, builds ever newer and higher stories, supports, purifies, renews the old cells, and endeavors above all to fill that gigantic framework and to arrange within it the whole of the empiric world." The scientific edifice will stretch past the sky like an endless erector set, but it is still built on a core of metaphor. But what if the metaphors are inherently limiting or even counterproductive? The problem the woman of so-called science faces is that the impulse towards the formation of metaphors, that fundamental impulse of man, that's Nietzsche again, withstands and is even used to interpret the regular and rigid new world that comes from the pursuit of knowledge and truth according to the scientific method. Scientific ideas, Nietzsche explains, are constantly confused by the construction of, quote, "new figures of speech, metaphors, metonymies, such that the existing world of waking man is ultimately rendered motley, irregular, inconsequentially incoherent, attractive, and eternally new as the world of dreams is." Such a beautiful writer. Part of the problem inherent in this marriage of metaphor and scientific knowledge is that individual metaphors exist, and this is Lakoff and Johnson, within a whole system of metaphorical concepts, concepts that we constantly use in living and thinking. These expressions, like all other words and phrasal lexical items in the language, are fixed by convention. The scientific disciplines use their own cosmologies of metaphor with which to produce and disseminate understanding. And medicine's central pain metaphors that marshal a mobile army of truth are of weapons and damage, as Scary has said, but also metaphors of neurology or the machine that include doors, keys, wires, and circuitry. I mentioned this my comment at the beginning of the day, and I'm going to make a lot of this definition because really it's influenced how pain research has been conducted ever since it was formed. We needed a standardized definition in order to conduct research. Pain was codified by the International Association for the Study of Pain, or the IASP. By the way, by a Canadian wrote that definition, Harold Merksey of the University of Western Ontario, in 1979 as, quote, "an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience associated with actual or potential tissue damage or described in terms of such damage." So unpleasant sensory and emotional experience, the word experience is in there, and there is either actual or potential damage, but then taking an even greater step, more distant step, described in terms of such damage. A single sentence long, this abstraction cannot convey what pain is or what it feels like. Textbooks that recount medical history often point out that the definition includes the parameter of emotion, taking back from the clinical hyperphysiological viewpoint of the 19th, 20th, and 21st centuries. And indeed, in some respects, the definition is quite progressive. Yet, nevertheless, the discipline's definition is a negative one restricted to metaphors of damage. That this definition is consistent with the concept of pain operating in general society, pain is a negative, noxious experience, does not mean that it is an adequate definition. For as Lakoff and Johnson show, our metaphors can work to increase or decrease understanding. It may be that the popular discourse around pain, which we're talking about today, and the difference between secular pain and other concepts of pain, it may be that the popular discourse around pain, pain is negative experience as expressed by metaphors of weaponry and damage, is in metaphorical terms the wrong road. If pain can only be negative, then pain will only be used for negative purposes and have negative effects. This is an inherent obstacle, obviously, to recovery from painful conditions. What is lacking in the ISP definition is the descent of possibility, a description of transcendent effects, of how this undeniably unpleasant experience has useful results for individuals and society. But the possible positivity of pain and its metaphorical roots in acute situations is a subject that I'll take up at the end of my paper. For now, it is important to recognize that the IASP definition, the canonical definition, is influential and provides the dominant metaphor for the whole branch, pain medicine. What is often ignored by medical professionals is the part of the ISP definition that defines pain as an experience. In present-day North America, pain is a clinical experience that is relegated to medicine for alleviation. People in pain largely go to doctors, to their detriment. In the culture of pain, David Morris asserts that, quote, the vast cultural shift that gives the story of pain its hidden plot centers on the eradication of meaning by late 19th century science. We are the heirs of the transformation in medical thought whereby we think of pain as no more than an electrical impulse speeding along the nerves. Medicine and the public use hegemonic metaphors to comprehend pain. Morris's text proceeds to examine how an inherently metaphorical understanding of pain absorbed by the larger public came into effect. The pathophysiological turn of the 18th century, the medical gaze of Foucault, things like that. There are problems with this wholesale relegation of pain to medicine, and I will consider these problems at length in some other form. Although it seems to me at a conference including faith and ethics and its thematics, we could maybe consider some of these problems in the discussion. And I'll conclude with a bunch of questions that you may or may not take up. For now, the history of pain theory and its basis in metaphor constitutes a narrative of progress. Textbooks like John Bonica's The Management of Pain, considered a standard in the field, briefly narrate the history of pain medicine as a single chapter before voluminously providing modern management principles. In their abbreviated historical sections, such textbooks commonly present pain as moving from a primitive to a sophisticated understanding. And in anatomical, physiological, and biochemical terms, that's incontestable. That's the magic trick. Yet in a paradoxical way, the progress narrative has been, qua Nietzsche, obliterated by the metaphor of progress. Progress becomes the narrative, obscuring a vast, systematic, and elaborate oversimplification as encouraged by metaphorical expression that conceals its nature as metaphor. Though neurological metaphors have assisted with the accumulation of scientific knowledge, their enshrinement as the means of understanding pain has had a terrible cost. We think of pain in terms of nerves, but nerves are not experience, and nerves are not necessarily emotion. Nerves are not pain. A powerful manifestation of the problem is visual. In particular, and you'll see the screen behind me as some examples, a powerful manifestation of the problem is visual. In particular, we rely upon visual metaphors as our interpretive tools. Within the medical discourse, there is a system of visual metaphors for pain. This paper I've written, published in Medical Humanities, unmasks some of those visual metaphors, and I'll touch on one of them. Such images are meant to represent progress while ignoring their provenance as metaphor due to the special nature of image, that of concretized truth. Though images are intended to be a simplification of truth, contemporary schematic explanations of pain represent a hearkening back to 19th century specificity theory, the labeled line theory. Injury here, travels this nerve, goes there, pain felt. Morris writes, We are the heirs of the transformation in medical thought whereby we think of pain as no more than an electrical impulse speeding along the nerves. We are the heirs, and we are in important ways re-innovators of the idea. Although the present deluge of diagrams and textual explanations of pain don't argue for a return to specificity theory per se, they do pretend to an immense knowledge of how one wire connects to another wire, leaving out the affective dimension entirely. Mechanisms are emphasized in medical discourse. What is pain is a difficult question to answer, but opiate and GABA receptors can be identified, tested in experiments, and the results published in articles rich with schematics and diagrams. In this way, the simple is represented simply, demonstrating the secret and dangerous power of visual representations that avoid images of human beings in pain. Standing on the shoulders of schematics, medicine appears powerful and knowledgeable. Yet the schematics are metaphors which perpetuate themselves to the detriment of a more complex truth. Schematics are visual metaphors that limit understanding because of their extreme simplicity. Pain medicine's learning curve is a way to police the door to understanding pain. That's a little trick physicians could do to anyone who wanted to pretend to knowledge of pain, and you could say, well, what do you know of the neurology of that? To understand pain from the medical point of view, one must first assimilate significant amounts of knowledge about basic neurophysiology, digesting basic explanations of how nerves conduct electricity, like, quote, neurons communicate by producing electrical impulses called action potentials. Action potentials are self-regenerative electrical signals that tend to propagate throughout a neuron and along its axon. The action potential is a depolarization of about 100 millivolts. I just ripped that from a very popular text, popular in terms of medical education. Leads to the seductive inference that it's not just electric impulse that's conducted, it's pain that's conducted. This inference is true in that there are certain nerve fibers responsible for transmitting certain kinds of pain, but it's not true that this signal is just that, a signal. It isn't pain. No nerve diagram with plus and minus signs on either side of a line representing a membrane turns knowledge into knowing. You'll see the schematic there. Now, I admit, who could look at such a diagram when in pain and say, this is pain? Also, admittedly, no student looks to diagrams, like the one above, to understand what pain is specifically. That's silly. Yet the unacknowledged metaphorical basis of the diagram, nerves are wires, and the fact that the diagram is a basic building block common in medical biological texts, leads to the creation of a powerful metaphor-based illusion. Much of the understanding of pain gets relegated to a diagram such as this one. Although to understand pain, one must learn nerve signaling, one should also recognize that nerve signaling serves as the physiological basis of a metaphorical system. The illusion is that more is known than is actually known because of the vast accumulated details pertaining to signaling mechanisms. Distortions occur among those without training and even those with training because of the nature of scientific progress identified by Nietzsche. There is more to pain that can be metaphorically illustrated by nerves, but a neurophysiologist too can quickly forget what is only partially apprehended by the hegemonic metaphors. For example, incredibly detailed mechanistic explanations of pain add little to the IASP definition of pain. Here's some words from the domain of molecular biology. Quote, the magnitude and nature of leak conductance determines membrane resistance and the impact a generator current will have on the membrane potential. Given the fact that there is considerable variation in the biophysical properties of sodium channels depending upon which alpha and beta subunits are present, the relative density of these subunits will have a significant impact on action potential threshold. Knowing which subunit communicates with another is important at the level of possible intervention sites for pharmacological therapy. But this knowledge does not augment the ISP definition. Yet such is the frontier of pain research, a perpetual spelunking of micro detail that fills the pages of the most prestigious journals. Pain researchers investigate the domain of receptor, ion, and protein fold. Molecular biology, neurophysiology, and reproductive neurobiology are the ascendant medical discourses of pain, and they are intoxicating precisely because of their reductive power. The danger, and I argue, implicit message, is that one doesn't need to bother with politics, religion, or power when viewing such diagrams. But one does. in Descartes' day, and for some time before that, Christianity, forgive me, that's the tradition I know, provided the Western world with a hegemonic pain discourse other than the medical. By building an iconography around Jesus Christ, Christianity used Christ's last days after re-entering Jerusalem, telling called the Passion in English, in a framework of human suffering. That pain serves as a conduit to God, that suffering intensifies one's relationship with the Maker. This relationship was presented as pleasurable and, even in some contexts like the poetry of Kershaw, a quasi-sexual one, albeit problematic, depending on one's point of view. The Christian attitude towards pain is more positive than that of the clinic. And ignoring politics and the conceptualization of pain is to ignore the maimed, war-torn world that pain makes. Mechanistic discourses are possibly inferior to religious ones in terms of articulating pain because of their inherent lack of meaning, connecting with Shai's thesis stated this morning. When modern-day Rene burns his finger, I called him Rene, he knows that physical pain is the result of nociceptors sending a signal from the periphery to the brain, as well as top-down processes modulating that same signal. As well, perhaps, a god overseeing the process. But Rene also knows much more that science doesn't know yet. Rene knows he can reach for certain medications that will give him analgesia. He knows he can thank the mechanistic discourse for that. But if he wishes to make sense of his pain, his knowledge of the spinal thalamic tract won't help him. If the fire was due to poor enforcement of building codes, or Rene lost his job to a global financial crisis, turned to state-taxed alcohol in order to numb his pain and inadvertently left a cigarette burning in bed, resulting in extensive burns, knowing how wire A leads to wire B won't help Rene cope on the burn unit. He has a problem of meaning, not a problem of neurology. Meaning is inherently bound up in metaphor, and Rene needs better metaphors to reflect the complexity of his plight. Medicine uses negative, damage or weapon, and neurological metaphors to the detriment of people in pain. How the uncertain and hypothetical nature of the metaphor is elided in favor of the illusion of authority and competence has done pain sufferers a disservice. By accumulating mountains of mechanistic detail, the affective component has been lost, as has the unstable nature of the understanding provided by science. Although negative and neurological metaphors explain pain to some extent, they are not sufficient. Other metaphors are necessary, as is realizing the contribution of narrative to the study of pain. I'm just going to end there because I think I'm close to my time, but I'm going to just throw a few questions out before response comes, and they are as follows. I admit that the metaphors that we use for pain have a useful practical dimension. Melzack in particular came up with the McGill Pain Questionnaire in 1974. Based on certain metaphors, do map to certain pain experiences in a clinical way, diagnoses, and I'm wondering how might the revolution in metaphor that I'm arguing for proceed? Why hasn't it occurred already in light of the relatively poor outcomes for pain, medicine, and at least from my neck of the woods, the unfolding public health disaster regarding opiates? Are there possible aesthetic approaches to pain? I started off this talk with a poem. But are there narrative medicine-based ways we could approach pain that just completely avoid pharmacology altogether? Finally, should medicine continue to possess some sort of ownership over the condition of pain? Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now have comments by Professor Yechiel Barilan. Yechiel Barilan is a practicing physician, specialist in internal medicine, and associate professor of medical education at the Sackler Faculty of Medicine at Tel Aviv University, and also my neighbor on the Sackler Faculty of Medicine. So it's nice to see you here, neighbor.
Thank you very much. I apologize that tomorrow I will not be present. I have another engagement in the Israeli bar talk. I thought we would spend dinner together, but today is my birthday. I'm becoming 50.
Wow.
That Safra prepared this conference on the occasion, of course. And I was hinted that a surprise was forthcoming from the side of family that may not be compatible with the dinner together, so let's see. Now, The contemporary scholarly literature on pain is deeply indebted to Aristotle's observation in the penultimate section of the third book of Nicomachean Ethics. Aristotle highlights a fundamental asymmetry between noxious and pleasant phenomena. I'm quoting from a translation. Self-indulgence is more like a voluntary state than a coitus. For the former, self-indulgence is actuated by pleasure, the latter, coitus, by pain, of which the one is to be chosen, the latter avoided. Pain upsets and destroys the nature of the person who feels it, while pleasure does nothing of this thought. Therefore, self-indulgence is more voluntary. Well, Aristotle argues A for pain as a unique phenomenon relative to others. Not only is it unique, it destroys the person. The uniqueness is radical. This may be well be the first formulation of the asymmetry hypothesis developed by much by Karl Popper, Meyerfield, and others. According to the asymmetry hypothesis, the negative side of the sensory continuum bears a special moral status. Aristotle discussed its agent-related meanings, the bearings on the cultivation of the virtues. Popper and contemporary ethicists underscore the patient side, the special treatment owed to the sufferer. Literary critics focus on meaning and authenticity in relation to the patient as well as his or her social environment. Even though not mentioned by Elian Scarry and perfunctorily by David Morris, Aristotle's observation lays the foundation of the leading thesis that pain effaces, dissolves the person. Authors imply that pain liquefies metaphysics and symbolic communication, stripping existence to bare crude sensations. Authors tend not to differentiate among pain and extreme pain, pain and suffering, suffering and total anguish. However, the onus of the pain discourse, mainly significant pain or extreme pain, rests on four pillars. Extremis, totalizing, it's an evolving phenomena, beyond metaphysics, and a privileged moral and semantic locus of the patient. These are the four pillars. The apparent contradiction between the beyond metaphysics and the privileged locus tenets is key to the metaphorical emotional dimensions of pain. When pioneer of palliative care, Cicely Saunders, referred to end-of-life agony as total pain, she pushed forward totality and metaphysical vulnerability, but offered a sort of holistic medicine, total care, she called it, as a redemptive solution. The hospice offers persons in transition into non-existence a locus of stability and meaning-finding. However, many critics, even late critics of the hospice movement, have given much more weight to the irremediable loss of agency and meaning. For Scarry and her followers, pain is a signifier without a signified. It points away, something to be avoided, unexpressed, rather than points at. Scarry writes, pain comes unshareably in our midst, as at once that which cannot be denied and that which cannot be confirmed. If a metaphor is the conception of one thing in terms of another within a context of understanding, as we just heard, this paradigm of pain talk refuses to acknowledge anything as the one thing it finds understanding preposterous. We have another standing for the undeniable and unshareable and unconfirmed. Harold Schweitzer draws an analogy to art. Like suffering, art has neither reference nor object nor utility. There is only the secret, unaccountable occurrence itself. I'm not sure all art theorists would agree with this conception of art. The analogy to pain talk, now conflated with suffering talk, is evident. It flies in the face of alternative traditions of pain talk, the hermeneutics of empathy, discussed by Carl Morrison, sacred or religious pain, discussed by anthropologists such as Ariel Gluckman, erotic pain, and others. Medical reductionism, discussed by Shane, has its liberating aspects as well. I will mention two examples. The introduction of obstetric anesthesia by means of reductionist positivist science liberated numerous women from enormous burdens of pain and chronic suffering, from the yoke of guilt, from the terror of death, and from elaborate symbolic systems that had been attached to childbirth since times immemorial. Today, for women in affluent societies, childbirth anesthesia is a matter of personal choice. Shall I do it with or without epidural? And much more subjected to her own conscientiously elaborated mesh of emotions and meanings. Once medicine limits itself to evoke potentials and neuroanatomy, it forgoes participation in the public debate whether childbirth anesthesia should be illegal and whether women should be encouraged to learn how to experience it as a sublimity rather than agony. The second example, not discussed by Scarifizer, has to do with the old association of pain and authenticity. In ancient Greece, torture would elicit truth out of wicked persons. Many people tried to substantiate the authenticity of their message and testimonies by their own personal suffering. Until this very day, we find attempts to justify torture of suspects as the only means to elicit a hugely important truth, prevention of terrorism, for example, from otherwise non-cooperating suspects. Hunger strikers inflict harm and torture upon themselves as to authenticate and underscore their cause. They self-represent as non-violent strugglers, hence celebrating weaponless pain, suffering as pure testimony. We believe that the sufferers, torturers, may use the mechanistic approach in order to intensify pain. However, the mechanistic approach does not and cannot inspire the motivation to inflict torture and the superstitious linkage between pain and truth. Rather, the more we study neurophysiology, the more we find links between extreme sensations and fantasy. David Morris observes that slaveholders in America argued that the Negro was less susceptible to pain and physical stress, and yet they resorted to corporal punishment of slaves. In a similar manner, we tend to represent extreme pain as effacing the person, negating metaphysics and sheer evading, while stressing the authenticating power of pain. The discipline of pain medicine is traceable to one person, the anesthetist, pugilist John Bonica. Urban legends and serious biographies trace his seminal 1953 textbook on pain medicine to either his chronic aches following years of wrestling or a near-fatal accident his wife suffered during obstetric anesthesia. We find here, in a nutshell, the two perennial archetypes of heroism and martyrdom, the masculine warrior on the one hand and the parturient woman on the other. In the Hebrew Bible, we find pain, etzev, in explicit association with childbirth, not woeful. The Christian saint, it's a comment, is an androgyn combining the victimhood of hostile violence with the eternal salvation of baptism by fire, rebirth. Not only did the Aztecs and other cultures glorify the collapsing warrior and the parturient mother and lavished honors on them. Even in the Jewish communities, women dying in childbirth were buried in the martyr's blood. Wounding and reproduction, in Scarry's word, are both associated with pain and death. A person must be on the limits, on the twilights of existence, and to suffer physical pain as to be a bearer of special truths. So successful has been modern biomedicine in the control of childbirth pain. It has disappeared from the philosophy and literary criticism of pain and suffering. Scarry doesn't discuss it. She discusses a lot the pain of the biblical discussion of infertility, but not childbirth pain. Attention is given almost exclusively to physical trauma and to metaphors of chronic pain and illness in terms of womb-making. The McGill Pain Questionnaire, also mentioned, contains over 80 metaphors. Only a few bear destructive connotations. None belongs to sexuality and childbirth. However, it is perhaps the threat of destruction which typifies contemporary pain talk. It is not the pain, but anxiety, fear of pain, which is not painful, as Aristotle observes, and consequently susceptible to volitional control and psychocultural molding. The move from intimacy with pain to anxieties about it reflects Christopher Lush's criticism of our culture as possessed with anxieties. We abandon guilt as Nietzsche urged us to, but as Shane says, we might have failed to leap in direction of creativity and instead coil in with anxiety. Creativity requires meaning, storytelling. Anxiety may grip us as a symbol without anything symbolized. As our mechanistic metaphors and scientific reductionism responsible for deleterious metaphorical schemes for pain and a loss of the emotional form in social construction? What is emotion? According to Aaron Ben-Zahev, a leading scholar of emotion from psychological and philosophical perspective, emotions have four basic components: the cognitive, the evaluative, motivatory, and the feeling. We feel an emotion. It is an experience. Emotion also contains an intentional, evaluative, and cognitive parts. Emotion motivates us to act upon it as well. If we operate within this paradigm, we should notice that it is quite impossible to behold extreme pain as negation of identity and metaphysics, and at the same time, seek pain's evaluative and cognitive parts. Thank you.
So we have a few minutes for discussion. Yes. Would everybody mind saying their name first so that we...
George Kush.
Thank you.
Can you pass the...
So it seems a challenge for medicine, not just in relation to pain, but in all areas of illness, is to integrate what are, at one level, very reductionistic moves. So it's not just played out in, you know, for action potentials and the circuits associated with pain, but you could, you know, take the networks of systems biology and the same cybernetic metaphors, you know, of the feedback loops and that, and extend them to upregulation and downregulation of genes and products produced that then explain illness. But illness isn't that, right? It's what patients experience. And even to put it in terms of that contrast is already making a certain move that perhaps is problematic. So then you appreciate, on one hand, the problematic reduction, and then on the other hand, exactly what we value about medicine is, so the reason why medicine has sort of this privileged role, both epistemically and in terms of its authority as gatekeeper, say, of drugs or whatever else, you know, all the transgressive deep cuttings of the body or poisonings of the body or whatever else, is that somehow that underlying knowledge gives you that privileged basis to do these transgressive prescribings or cuttings. So how do you, because it, from your comments, I took that as the critical thrust of it, the problematic character of those metaphors taken as what pain is. But the other side is that need of the physician to somehow bring that underlying narrative together with that richer analysis you're providing, the move you're wanting to make with metaphors in that, does it help us do that? Or are you left in sort of two worlds divided? One, that kind of reductionistic language, the other, the resources associated with the metaphorical work you're advocating?
That's a good question. I guess I'd answer it by evading it in a way, or at least stepping back from it and saying, I don't think the solution is in medicine for pain. Usually when I say that to people, they look at me and they go, what do you mean? You know, but I just kind of say, well, maybe the problem that we have with pain is that doctors are entrusted to manage it, and they have these metaphors, and maybe we should do something else. So my actual argument is that the metaphors themselves are the problems. It's not medicine's problem per se. It's all our problems, but we invest in the medical edifice too much authority, too much. We presume an efficacy that isn't present, specifically with regards to pain. So your reductionist, your comment upon medicine's reduction, your identification of my argument about medicine's reductionism in terms of these metaphors is accurate. And I say that is it medicine's fault that these metaphors are used? I say that no, actually these metaphors are largely used by patients. And I'm really heartened quite a lot by the fact that scary's come up so much today, because in other pain conferences I've attended, people, you know, scary's old hat, we don't need to think scary anymore, we've moved on. But her actual focus on metaphor, because the second half of her book is actually the creation of the world, so it's actually constructive metaphors derived from the Bible, which do have some wounds in them, actually. The change that I'm arguing for to occur in metaphor needs to occur outside of medicine. I don't think medicine can do it. I think that we think in terms of drug, and I think that we think so deeply and so entrenched in terms of solving a problem with pharmacology. It's our natural state for many brands of medicine, for many physicians. That's a generalization, but I think it's largely so, and probably maps with people's experience of going to physicians, I would just hazard a guess. I don't think we actually can fix the problem from within medicine. I think it needs to happen from outside, and I look at communities such as LGBTQ communities in which language has been pushed back against. In other words, the stigma has been taken and used, for example, as a weapon, pushed back to say, to reclaim these words that are used as pejorative. In medicine, or, sorry, in society, I would say maybe we can make more positive metaphors. Maybe people can describe their experience in a more positive way, and then that's the way to affect change backflowing into medicine. Finally, you're right. To say that medicine only works this way, reductively based on metaphor, isn't completely true, although I think it's a large component of what doctors do. It's not completely true. There's a brand and ascendant kind of medicine which is its own hegemony called narrative medicine, which seeks to balm the wounds of all sufferers by using story, you know. And I also think that there's some big problems with that kind of rollout as well. But the claims made by narrative medicine, which are totalizing, I can understand your experience. If you tell it to me, then we will know one another. There's a major overclaim there. And I think that's intrinsic to that particular brand. So no matter what way you cut it, nothing's perfect. But I do think that the change probably isn't going to occur within medicine. I think it's the metaphor change is probably going to happen from people.
Just a brief follow-up. Is the moves like that of anti-psychiatrists with respect to illness
that for other medical conditions, sort of somatically regarding them is legitimate, but for pain, you know, analogous to the way Thomas Sass would speak of mental illness, the category's illegitimate and excluded in that domain?
That's an interesting analogy, and I would say there are similarities, but I would say not completely. By no means do I mean to say that, you know, throughout the DSM it's a load of bunk, and what we call psychiatric categories of illness are invented and fictional and don't exist. And I have no efficacy in the world, because I think that that's not true. I do think that these categories that are within the diagnostic and statistics manual do exist. There is a thing called depression. Although what we call these things changes over time, these things do exist, and treating them does get people better. So it's similar, but with pain, we have a branch or a little lacuna within medicine in which outcomes are so poor. The relative benefit you can get from reductionist thinking in medicine, for example, transplantation that we talked about today, major advances continually being done. A new drug will come out every few years that arrests cancer, a certain form in its tracks, as long as, of course, you pay $20,000, $30,000 a year for it. These huge advances, these huge benefits are being seen by society all the time. And I think that if you kind of switch your head around really fast, you can, you know, that's the effect that society has. You turn your head really quick, and eventually you think the same is true for pain medicine as well. But my experience is that it's a very difficult problem. It's getting worse in North America with the prescription of opiates as a solution, and that the reductionist thinking that has benefited so many other areas of medicine, strangely enough, is the big part of the problem in pain medicine. Drew?
I guess I should have the mic. This is sort of a question or comment kind of for both of you, because I kind of feel like playing devil's advocate, even though I'm, you know, almost totally in sympathy with what's been said. And I think this may touch on one of the directions you were going in, to sort of press for the positive roles that this reductionist strain has played in relation to many conditions and even maybe in relation to pain. For example, in Alcoholics Anonymous, alcoholics who felt tremendously sinful and guilty and weak-willed were assisted when a disease model was introduced and said, you have an illness, you're not just a bad person. And there was a tremendous relief of guilt. And it seems like there are syndromes, you know, you were talking about pregnancy, and I was also thinking about things like chronic fatigue syndrome, or people with various kinds of diffuse pain manifestations, where there's a tremendous relief when the physician says, oh, there is a real mechanical thing that's going on in your body. You know, this is not just something you're fantasizing about and creating through your neurosis. Susan Sontag talked, you know, in her book, I forget if it was on metaphor, illness as metaphor, about the tremendous damage done by metaphors in relation to people who have cancer, you know, who feel that they have a kind of cancer-prone personality, and they're also bedeviled by some of the negative metaphorical images that have arisen around cancer. And once again, just to be given a more, you know, kind of reductionist mechanical understanding of what has, you know, how the cancer cells are propagating, she finds as in many ways kind of healing or relieving. So I'm just sort of raising this dialectic between the harm that's been done by these kinds of reductionist mechanical metaphors, and also, you know, both the treatments that it has supported, but even more on the kind of psychological, emotional level, the ways in which it does have some positive outcomes. And so I'm sort of throwing that out to the both of you, since you touched on that as well.
In such a setting that we have a conference on pain, talk about pain, revivify pain, in reality, certain pain situations, I mean, subjected to medical control very easily. And medicine is a huge triumph, whatever is the approach. And some others, as you pointed out more, medicine doesn't manage despite the best of theory. And we don't know whether we are talking about the same phenomenon, whether medicine is about it. This is the medical futurism. It's just about time until we get to catch your pain. Or there are certain aspects that we call pain, but they are beyond the medical tools. Same applies also to the philosophical and literary tradition. Sometimes they manage to give lots of meaning, and people transcend pain or even seek pain experience in the name of culture, in the context of culture, and celebrate them. And sometimes the religion or tradition or culture are quite oppressive in relation to pain. So we need to acknowledge the limits and powers of each direction. That's why in my response in brief, I said, look, medical reductionism has its value. It's not an argument. It's not, I mean, just let's look at it, acknowledge it. And part of the problem with a redeeming emotion metaphor doesn't lie in medicine. It lies in the tradition of philosophy and literary criticism, that if pain really annihilates the person and so forth, this, it doesn't leave much space for developing metaphor. That's practically the essence of what I said. I mean, we don't really know what which pain belongs to which.
You wanted to say something?
Thank you very much. I have a question regarding, you had the statement that when something like metaphors that we use shape our understanding, right? So versus represent our understanding, right? And I'm wondering about this understanding and perhaps an interesting, I mean, it's not a question, just a thought. An interesting perspective, and that would be to differentiate between the use of metaphors in medicine, which would be a way that we can criticize or not to understand or to define pain, whereas the philosophical perspective would be the use of metaphors to think about the meaning of pain. And you referred to Nietzsche. Nietzsche has some very interesting remarks in the Gay Science about that, where he says something like the main problem is not human suffering or pain, but the fact that this suffering cannot be given meaning or cannot be understood. Another, I mean, this kind of a split between the medical and the philosophical treatment of pain has another aspect to it, and that is that, as we heard in the discussion, that the medical perspective, the focus of the medical perspective would be cure, right? Treatment, to allow the patient to transcend this terrible state of pain, etc. Whereas the philosophical perspective would not transcend so fast, right? It would have to do with our way to be in pain and to understand the meaning of pain outside the question of whether we can cure it or not.
The two different traditions have different ways of approaching it and different metaphorical basis to understand pain. I think that the struggle that has occurred since society's embarked upon the pathophysiological medical enterprise is to reinvest meaning in pain. And that is what I argue with change in our metaphors, to allow some possible positivity into the explanation. But one can certainly use philosophy as a means to inflect that. You mentioned Aristotle at the beginning of the talk, and Aristotle is ritually mentioned in the medical texts which describe pain. It's the kind of medical humanities light that these texts tend to do. There's a four-line quote called "Passion of the Soul." Pain is a passion of the soul. And that's deployed. And then we move on. We mention a few other people along the way, like Descartes. That's medicine's version of philosophy. So I think if philosophy gave its, if there was more substance to medicine's understanding of philosophy itself, we'd probably get pretty far. I tried to research Aristotle's definition of pain and quickly ran into an escalating series of impediments, just like I would run into a series of impediments if I wanted to understand the neurophysiological basis of pain without a training. Aristotle says it's a passion of the soul. What does he mean by passion? What does he mean by soul? Climb up a mountain, and learn that history. I take your point for sure.
Okay, we're going to move to the next, but I'll just take the one or two people. We have time? Okay.
Right, we started at 15, after? 20, 120 or something. Each presentation has more than an hour.
Okay.
Sorry.
You're the boss. Go ahead.
No.
And you wanted to say something too, right? Okay.
So I guess this is following on some of the points that have already been made, but maybe a little bit differently. So I guess my basic question is, there's a medical language to talk about pain. That's not new in itself. So there are old languages of medicine to talk about pain, which at least to a certain extent have similar problem, or at least I'm asking whether there's anything unique about modern medicine in the way that it works, as opposed to historical forms of medicine. And so, you know, if you say, you know, you're in pain because you're possessed by the devil, okay, and that's not the medical framing, but or if you say you're in pain because your bowels, you're not, you know, you're not balanced, it's not about you. It's about something that is happening to you on some level. So the so to say, the question is, what is, when you call it reductionist, what work is that doing, and what why is it important that it's reductionist? What does a reductionism give us, and what characterizes, what makes modern medicine unique in this way in comparison to other ways of understanding pain?
My answer would end up being a critique of biomedicine, largely based on your question. The idea that things can be scientifically proven, measured, quantified, and that is something that really started at least in the 18th century with the anatomical view. When you mention, is there something unique to it? I mean, the Galenist building on Hippocrates' theory of humors, it's quite a bit different, I think, than the current.
No, it is, but what it is different, and you're saying one difference is that it's not a exact science.
No, I'm saying
It wasn't measurable in the way that today is measurable.
Actually,
but is that what's this like? Is that the important difference?
No, and yes, in that there is a problem when we attach numbers and we begin to assign values to things, and we lose sight of the larger story. But there is a big difference between Galenist medicine and current biomedicine, in that with Galenist medicine, if the humors are to balance, then you need to balance those humors with various things that don't necessarily result to a pharmacology. You need to change your life. Medicine, current biomedicine, really doesn't look upon the body as holistically as that. So I would say there's a lot more positivity even in medical pain theory, if I have it correct, I think.
Matt's answer?
Oh, yeah, of course.
Well, more than 2,000, 3,000 years ago, Herophilus of Alexandria, one of the pioneer anatomists, he was the first to describe the dermatomes, that the areas of the body communicated by specific nerves, and map it out. And some claim, by the way, that he did it experimenting on live prisoners, dissecting them. That's a controversial issue. But since Herophilus, medicine had not dealt with pain because it had nothing to offer in terms of pain. You try to help, to balance humors, but there was no response to it. So he started walking in the direction of reductionism, but there was nothing to do. And with the evoke potential and processes, two things happen. First, people realize that all of the nervous system works on the same principle. Whatever I feel, qualia or pain or thought, all has to do with evoke potentials. At least this is part of the process. And then medicine found ways to target these very specifically. So there's a huge leap in the history of medicine, from identification of particular processes the way you showed, to finding some responses to these particular processes. But medicine is an enterprise that did not deal with pain. If I cure you, your pain should have passed.
Can start.
Thank you.
I was wondering whether that notion of authenticity could help us somehow make a distinction between different kinds of pains, and because usually what we hear these two, either the reductionist approach, which is meant to eliminate pain altogether, or the more religious discourse on pain, which is that it's somewhat redeeming, it has to be with meaning, it is interesting in its own sake. And, you know, Michael, when you described the female and with the giving birth and the male experience of war and the different pains, putting them on the same footing, seems to me that the childbearing pain is something that precisely could be something of an authentic, something that is, that is, that is lived as authentic and as acceptable for the person herself, whereas something that is passively associated with, you know, something that is inflicted, something that is not leading anywhere, could be less. I see an enormous difference between the two. Now, maybe also in the medical domain, we should strive towards this, taking into account what, in order to decide whether we should suppress pain or not, and to what extent, whether this pain is what is it to the person, whether the person is taking it actively to do something with it. I hear on the, you know, many patients say that they don't want them to be too much sedated because they lose something or a contact with their own self somehow. And the delivery, it's exactly that. I was among those who said, you know, you don't want this because it loses one of the part of the experience. And so I took it upon myself and was very happy about it, but I can understand that some women would not want, but it seems to be very different than just being shot, you know, with a, anyway.
Anyone else who wanted to say something?
I just had a brief comment in relation to the point that you brought up, Shai, about is there anything unique about the modern medical reductionism? And I wonder if it does have to do with this model of the machine, you know, that the Cartesian, what's been called the death of nature, when nature is reconceived no longer in terms of a living organism, you know, our holistic macrocosm that then is reflected in the microcosm of the body, but simply as a machine which can be analyzed into its component parts and forces, and which is predominantly modeled on the inanimate automata of Descartes' day, you know, what we would now call robots, or, you know, modes of artificial intelligence. And so to take the living and something as profoundly a living phenomenon as pain and the human experience of illness, and to try to schematize it according to machine functioning, does seem like it may be uniquely reductionist in the history of medicine compared to systems of the humors or...
You first. Very brief. The reductionist option changed things, because before obstetric anesthesia, women did not talk like you, I want to have my own experience. There was religion, guilt, many other issues. Once obstetric anesthesia appeared, women rushed to the hospitals in search for relief. Then many have discovered or find out for themselves it might be better not to have the anesthesia for the medical condition or for the particular situation, but they did not revert back to the old meaning system, because the natural birth movement today is about autonomy, empowerment, having experience. It's completely different from the anesthesia absent childbirth of the past. So in this sense, even if you don't take pain control, the availability of pain control in this situation has transformed the worlds of meaning.
Yeah, kind of, you know, if you build it, they will come kind of philosophy, which medicine really does try to supply. I was just going to close by saying I really brought in the reductionist view of medicine in for a lot of abuse, I guess, but I kind of reserve it for the special domain of pain in particular. I'd say, though, that I'd be easier on it if it was sincere, and here's what I mean. I don't think it's sincere, at least in contemporary life, with regards to pain, because the amount of money that is invested in research for a magical drug that will assist people in pain is vast, but the efficacy is low. There are no studies out there, which I'm resorting to the medical literature now, so forgive me. There are no studies out there which prove the benefit of opiates in the context of chronic low back pain over the course of a year or after. Pharma studies only follow the drug a maximum of about 3 months. That's usually as far as they go, and that's pretty long. Sometimes it's only 6 weeks, sometimes it's 10 or 12. So the maximum, 3 months, that's as far as they follow these drugs for, but we're commonly prescribing them for chronic pain which lasts longer than 3 months. And meta-analysis in the Annals of Internal Medicine published in 2015, yet another meta-analysis which said, the evidence says that opiates, there is a dose-dependent harm, but there is no evidence of their efficacy. So there's dose-dependent morbidity and mortality associated with these drugs, but nobody's studying drugs past 3 months. Nobody's actually doing the reductive work. Nobody's actually going out there and saying, we're going to prove this. This is something that we're actually going to look into and authenticate, and I wonder why that is. So lots of money invested in finding a drug that might work, and very little money or very little research invested in actually proving that they do work. So it's the insincerity of it that I really wonder about. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I, as a person who likes stories, I was going to ask you to demonstrate a good use of stories and narration, but to some extent we got it with the story of the birth, how the story changed, but could still be used in terms of controlling pain. And I think behind your last words is a different story, unrelated maybe to pain, which is the politics of money and drugs and their impact on medicine, which is a very big other story. So we'll see if we have some more time in the end to explore this. But we will now move to the second session, second part of the session. Thank you so much, both of you. And first, I'm very happy to introduce Professor Rainier Bromer. He's a tenured professor at the Department of History of Medicine and Bioethics at Istanbul University. His fields of interest include medical bodies in the Ottoman Empire, Islam and science, medicine in the 19th and 20th century, and medicine studies and medical humanities. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for this kind introduction. Actually, for foreigners, there is no tenured position in Turkey, so I'm not lucky.
Well, the word there, tenure, was somewhere there, and I didn't know what to do with it. So.
We would hope. Thank you for inviting me here, and again, apologies for sending around my paper so late. I do have some printouts if people want to read along. We can just, each pack is one paper. And since you didn't have a chance to read it in advance, I will read the whole paper and I'll just present the main outline. So the topic is on suffering and pain in humans and non-human animals in the Ottoman and early Republican Turkish history. And I wanted to start with a brief half verse from the Quran. Do the people think that they will be left to say, we believe, and they will not be tried? This is one possible aspect that we could see under theodicy from an Islamic perspective. Living beings are enmeshed in paradoxical relationships, as only a small range of organisms can grow, feeding on non-biological substances. Life presupposes death, the death of others, that is, and ultimately the death of one's own body. All animals need organic matter for their nutrition, and depending on their biological nature, some of them are able or even required to eat meat. Most animals, including humans, though we can live without consuming animals or animal products, are unable to deactivate the toxins forming in carrion. Hence, they are forced to kill or find freshly killed animals to feed. And killing almost inevitably involves pain. While this line of argument looks perfectly straightforward, there is now, thanks to ubiquitous recording equipment, a flood of evidence showing that not only humans, but a number of carnivorous animals occasionally display protective behavior towards individual members of other species that are normally part of their prey. A lioness in the wild defending a young wild beast from her pride, a tiger in captivity sharing his enclosure with a goat, which eventually drives away but even then does not kill, or any number of human pets in various potential food chain constellations. Obviously, the food chain is not the only connection between humans and other animals. Domesticated wolves have been used in hunting even before sedentary life was established, and human cultures almost everywhere make use of a wide variety of animal products, from dairy, honey, and eggs provided by the living, to furs, leather, and horns procured from the dead. In addition, humans interact with other animals spatially, sharing and encroaching into their habitats, fending them off from their crops, building over their territories, and allowing them into human settlements, like the birds nesting in buildings, and the stray dogs in the streets that we will hear a lot more about later in this talk. These increasing interactions on various levels have raised human awareness of animal well-being and suffering, though not preventing an inordinate amount of systematic atrocities committed out of sight of the general population in industrialized farming and slaughtering facilities, or through environmental pollution beyond the point of livability in many parts of the world. The ethical implications of these interactions have only recently attracted the systematic attention of philosophers such as Will Kimnitzka, who, after working on multicultural citizenship among humans, turned his interest towards animals in the margins of human activity in the influential book Zoopolis that he wrote with his wife, writer Sue Donaldson, in 2011. It is actually fascinating to see how neatly their description of urban animal life matches the reality of the already mentioned stray dogs in Istanbul's streets, cared for within the neighborhoods, though not being taken into possession by humans individually. However, limitations of growth govern modern human civilizations. Proliferation of population is no longer only reined in by misery, hunger, and disease, but most societies in most places apply some sort of welfare and family planning. Thus, human suffering has come to be seen as less inevitable, and in post-industrial as well as newly industrialized countries, expectations of a substantial number of quality-adjusted life years are commonly accepted. The same does not hold for animal populations, where equilibrium is generally achieved through predation, while the top predators are controlled by the availability of prey or by pests, hence potential misery, hunger, and disease. Thus, the sometimes harmonious relationship between human and non-human communities in built-up or cultivated areas is regularly punctuated by the perceived need for interventions, such as deportation or eradication. Only in rare cases and in a few places, humans exert some kind of precarious family planning through castration, for instance, again, the street dogs in Istanbul, or oral contraception for pigeons in some major cities around the world. Today's dominant Muslim view of the relationship between humans and other animals drawing on classical scholarship, is markedly anthropocentric, considering other species as being created specifically for human use and consumption. Thus, only recently a very marginal discourse has emerged questioning the ritual obligation of animal sacrifice at the end of the annual pilgrimage season. Even though the practice is not prescribed in the Quran itself, the Hadith literature contains strong recommendations in favor of the shedding of blood of a sacrificed animal. On the whole, humans' entitlement to make use of animals tends to go along with a strong sense of responsibility to avoid unnecessary suffering and pain. From the prophetic tradition, the Hadith transmission, one example, Shadid ibn Aus says, "Two are the things which I remember Allah's messenger, but may peace be upon him, having said, verily Allah has enjoined goodness to everything, so when you kill, kill in a good way, and when you slaughter, slaughter in a good way. So every one of you should sharpen his knife and let the slaughtered animal die comfortably." Islamic ethicists emphasize humanity's roles as stewards, khilafa, representing God vis-a-vis his worldly creation. In Islamic societies, measures protecting animals from suffering and anxiety include specific rules for slaughtering, not unlike in secular contexts, but also legal regulations for the use of work animals and rules for the treatment of pets. Suffering in humans is considered in its potentially redemptive quality, trusting that, again a quote from the Quran, Allah does not charge a soul except with that within its capacity. However, no such theodicy can be assumed for animals that are not believed to possess an immortal soul. In general, traditional Islamic law assigns humans a degree of responsibility for other animals that forbids any unwarranted killing beyond acquisition of food and self-defense. The Hadith literature contains injunctions against hunting for entertainment or collecting trophies rather than for food. While certain animals considered to be harmful are mandated to be killed, including crows, mice, poisonous snakes, and scorpions. An ambivalence towards the absolute value of non-human life, consistent with the paradoxical stance introduced at the beginning of this talk, going right back to the formative period of Islam. At this point, we may also want to consider that human life, too, is only considered untouchable unless there are valid reasons for killing a person, as in the usually incompletely quoted Quranic verse that whoever kills a soul unless for a soul, lex talionis, or for corruption done in the land, it is as if he had slain mankind entirely. And this term corruption, fasad, offers a wide range of justifications for executing anyone from insurgents to apostates. A continuous thread in the Islamic literature is the conviction that animals can suffer. I'm not aware of any Muslim authors arguing in a Cartesian vein that animals might be unfeeling automata, and that it is humans' duty to prevent unnecessary pain. Thus, the 16th century physician Daud al-Antaqi explicitly emphasizes that a veterinarian must be aware that animals, like people, also suffer, and therefore he must treat them with compassion and gentleness. At the same time, with relatively few exceptions, Muslim thinkers take for granted humans' right to kill animals for legitimate reasons, though not arbitrarily. God created animals for human sustenance and support, indispensable pack and work animals in the original Arabian economy. Thus, equality between species is generally not envisaged in the Islamic literature, but even so, animals are never equated with inanimate objects to be dealt with and disposed of at will. And not only the animal's own sensations were to be taken into consideration, but also, according to 13th century jurist As-Sulami, its feeling for its young, which were not to be killed within the sight of the parent. On the other hand, the same As-Sulami branded as unbelief the giving of preference to a lower animal over a higher one, the latter higher one referring especially to human beings. As in all other sectors of life, social practice did not adhere to the most austere interpretation of religious precepts. Thus, hunting with horses, hounds, and falcons was widely practiced throughout much of Islamic history, while on the other hand, the collection of specimens for scientific purposes, in analogy to European Renaissance chambers of miracles, Wunderkammern, and later museums, does not seem to have been known. By and large, then, we can generalize that Muslim societies, including the Ottoman Empire, about which we have more comprehensive information, considered the avoidance of causing pain to animals as a human obligation, while not questioning the destruction of animal lives for sustenance or self-defense. An interesting debate surrounds the question of the acceptability of vegetarianism or veganism for the Muslim faithful. Though we find precursors for this debate in the classical period of Islam, it is mainly of recent date. If anything, it is the renunciation of meat that is considered to require an ethical justification, not its consumption. From the canonical permissibility of slaughtering, commentators derive criticism against foregoing it. Thus, a contemporary Indian jurist, Ali Ashraf Thanwi, comparing the nature of slaughter and capital punishment, both being sanctioned by God, according to him, are prescribed in that they ensure the well-being of the human society at large. A passage from the noted environmental ethicist Mawir Izzeddin deserves being quoted at greater length. Quote, "Muslims are not only prohibited from eating certain food, but also may not choose to prohibit themselves from that is allowed by Islam. Accordingly, vegetarianism is not permitted unless on grounds such as unavailability or medical necessity. Vegetarianism is not allowed under the pretext of giving priority to the interests of animals, because such decisions are God's prerogative. On the other hand, it is known that in the past and present, especially certain Sufi thinkers advocated a vegetarian diet out of compassion for animals, usually without receiving wider acceptance among Sunni and Shia Muslims. But let us now focus on a carnivorous species populating Ottoman and Turkish cities, notably Istanbul, stray dogs. Early European visitors to the city on the Bosphorus were struck by the way in which the local population was taking care of their canine neighbors, respecting their presence, even in inconvenient locations, and catering for their needs, providing food especially prepared by dedicated kitchens in the city and purchased by local people to be handed out to the animals. In the late 16th century, an Austrian ambassador does not fail to mention, however, that sometimes when the dogs were seen to have become too numerous, they were exiled across the Bosphorus, being left to fend for themselves in the woodlands on the Asian shore, a practice we will observe repeatedly, conforming to the paradoxical constellation introduced at the beginning of this talk. Too much can be too much, even under the assumption of respecting one's non-human neighbors. In Muslim culture, dogs are playing an ambivalent role. Some hadiths can be read to mean that the Prophet demanded the extermination of all but trained guard and shepherd dogs, and other hadiths report that, according to the Prophet, the presence of a dog in a human habitation would prevent angels from entering there and diminish the value of a person's good deeds. Since touching dogs renders ritual ablution invalid, most Muslims, even while taking care of these creatures, will not pat them nor allow them into their houses. This reluctance can still be observed in Muslim countries such as Turkey, despite the traditionally dog-friendly attitudes displayed. It is often claimed that profound change occurred during modernization, from the new state order launched by Sultan Mahmud II in 1839 to the absolutist era of Abdulhamid II and into the early republic, not only in the political arena but also at a deeper socio-cultural layer, affecting the ways people would deal with one another and with non-human animals. This is where we are coming back to the fate of Istanbul's stray dogs. Throughout Ottoman times, especially European travel writers have left numerous testimonies about the common presence of dogs in Constantinople streets. It may reflect more the visitor's mindset than local attitudes, when most visitors interpret the inhabitants' lenience with the dogs through their function as scavengers, keeping the streets clean. Pingue's brief survey of literature examining Muslim attitudes to animals does not bear out such a utilitarian approach. There's a number of well-known episodes, especially from the era of modernizing sultans Mahmud II and Abdulaziz, so between 1839 and 1876, where official measures taken to control the stray dog population in Istanbul failed spectacularly, with strong winds liberating the captive animals from a boat in distress, allowing them to reach the shore swimming, or a great fire ravaging the city center shortly after the deportation of the court and Mannheims, understood by the local populace as a divine sign of disapproval, leading to the restitution of the dogs to their original habitat, to the acclaim of the commoners. At the turn of the 20th century, under the heavy rule of Abdulhamid II, the free-ranging, self-organized packs of dogs could even be turned into a metaphor for the lost freedom of human society. Thus, the disgraced former personal physician to the Sultan, Spiridion Mavroyeni, a Greek Orthodox Christian, published a small book in French about Les Chiens Errants de Constantinople, Stray Dogs of Constantinople, in 1902, where he extolled the virtues of the canine republic and pointed out that, quote, men have not wanted to subject the dogs to their will, nor use them by imposing on them various services they are capable of. In real life, on the contrary, a call for extermination of dogs could be a fanfare for modernization. A contemporary of Mavroyeni's, lapsed Muslim doctor Abdullah Cevdet, saw the packs of dogs as standing in the way of progress, cleanliness, and order, and vehemently argued for killing those, quoted, supposedly miserable and impure creatures. He embarks on a paradoxical argument against religious scholars defending the animals, himself resorting to religious traditions vilifying dogs as unclean. Episodes of dog cleansing in Istanbul recurred during the Unity and Progress regime coming into power in 1908 and into the Republican period. Major interventions are on record for the years 1910, 1912, and repeatedly in the 1920s and 30s. When dogs were to be collected and deported to a small island off Istanbul, where they would die under atrocious circumstances, as eyewitnesses reported, the municipality orders turned out to be hard to implement in the Muslim quarters of the city, where gypsies were brought in to apprehend the animals, while in Christian neighborhoods, local youths would be eager to earn the bounty offered by the municipality. According to a Christian missionary, Père Colomban, even requisitioned cart drivers refused to take part in the operation, replying that, quote, this was a sin and they preferred going to jail. A similar narrative of modernization can be found with regard to the treatment of needy humans, especially the mentally ill, for whom, medical historian Neilson showed that westernized clinical approaches led to a rapid decline in society's readiness to accommodate troublesome individuals in their midst. What makes the assessment of these claims so difficult is the fact that they are embedded in a particularly laden Occidentalist narrative, assuming that the process of modernization imposed on the Ottoman peoples from above during the last 190 years somehow led to a progressive loss of humane attitudes towards other human and non-human living beings. We may well ask how well-founded such a perspective can be in the light of our current knowledge about Ottoman sociocultural history without falling into a more presentist prejudice, suggesting a steady progress of human-animal relations from the Renaissance to our times. The main direction of further investigation envisaged with this paper, however, is the ambivalence stated at the very beginning. While it is easy to find isolated references to Muslims' concrete or metaphorical dealings with non-human pain and suffering, in the religious and legal literature, as well as in textual and pictorial sources from everyday life, it seems crucial to analyze the ineluctable conflict between emotional and ecological needs in the interaction between human and non-human actors in the civilized space. This conflict is, of course, far more fundamental than the specific religious stipulations, which, as we have seen, tend to be ambiguous at the best of times. An entirely abstract approach reflecting animals' capacity to suffer will not stand the test of practice in organized human community. As pointed out at the very beginning, Life and death are inextricably linked, and death without pain and suffering is still the exception, even within the human realm. The bioethical literature that I'm aware of, and I will be very grateful for any indications to the contrary, does not usually engage in the debate of universal practicability. The more fundamentally philosophical literature, quite appropriately, focuses on the values at stake, qualities required for ethical significance, and isolated suggestions for practical measures, such as veganism and substitution of animal experiments. Activists, like people for the ethical treatment of animals or the more radical Animal Liberation Front, focus on implementation, mostly without a sustained analysis of the values entailed. A scripture-based religion such as Islam is in a particularly difficult situation to accommodate a developing social discourse located far outside the tradition of the religion in question, and even in an ostensibly secular country such as Turkey, advocates of veganism are facing vehement and not uncommonly violent opposition from representatives of an anthropocentric Sunni mainstream who adhere to classical interpretations of Islamic traditions requiring the ritual slaughtering of animals, at least on the occasion of the sacrifice holiday. The examples presented above allow us to contextualize the changing attitudes towards animal suffering in the Ottoman Empire in the process of top-down modernization on a Western model, which is very well established. What is far less clear is the precarious balance between respect and control, which, while it neatly fits the modernization narrative, must have caused concern throughout history, as the hadith transmitting the Prophet's injunction to destroy the cohabiting dog population attests. Thus, we are left with the uncomfortable question about what we would now call population management in the contact zone between human and wildlife habitats, as conceptualized by Donaldson and Kimnitzka. Thank you very much.
Let me just introduce you. But I can't stop myself. Are they still stray dogs in Istanbul?
They are. They are now being castrated as far as the municipality gets hold of them. You can recognize them by earmarks, the castrated ones. Of course, it's not totally successful. And this ambivalent situation of carrying them, feeding them, sometimes poisoning them, still continues. So this situation is really an ongoing situation.
In Jerusalem, we have stray cats. What about Tel Aviv? Cats?
Dogs. Okay. And I'm going to talk about that. So don't
worry. Okay. So, Professor Lina Salaime is Associate Professor at Tel Aviv University Law School. She researches and teaches Islamic and Jewish jurisprudence in both historical and contemporary legal systems. She is Robbins Associate Research Fellow at University of California in Berkeley School of Law, where she was previously Robbins Postdoctoral Fellow. Professor Salaime earned her PhD in Legal and Middle Eastern History from University of California in Berkeley and her JD from Harvard Law School. She's a member of the California Bar. Thank you.
I prefer not to be recorded. If you could turn that off, I would appreciate it. Thank you. So I'm sorry, too, that I wasn't here this morning. I'm still suffering, really, from the flu. So thank you, Rainier, for the interesting glimpse into an aspect of Ottoman history that is new to me. I don't research animals at all, and my background is in Islamic legal history prior to the Ottoman era, so I'm really not going to speak to the specific insights of the paper, but what I want to try to do is elaborate a little bit on the Islamic legal ideas you mentioned in your paper and think about some of the historical questions you present. So as you rightly point out, not causing unnecessary suffering is an Islamic legal principle applied to both humans and to animals. Torture is actually prohibited according to Islamic law. So you noted that the Orthodox Islamic perspective views the relationship between humans and animals in an anthropocentric way, that is, that animals are created